Yellow.
A podcast by Designit.
Design what matters.
Smile.
If we can't save our privacy, we won't save human beings and we won't save democracy. So I do believe that we can do it, but it might be, unfortunately, mainly the privileged, at least in the beginning, who will have this. The rich and the famous and the powerful, they would really need this. Just like with organic food, privacy will be for the rich.
You're listening to Yellow.
Hello, curious people. Thanks for joining us on the first episode of Yellow by Designit, created by the very designers who work there. I'm Phil, your host, and one of those designers. Shall we dive straight in? Then let's go.
You're listening to
Yellow.
To kick things off, we're exploring the world of trust. Actually, data privacy and data ethics, to be precise. Media theorist Douglas Rushkoff recently said, "Our digital platforms are being coded by people who don't have our best interests at heart." Can that be right? Exactly how much thought has gone into how our personal data is used by the services we can't live without? Design plays a crucial role in shaping the way we address the use of data and the right to privacy of people, a role that will steer future products and services. But are the digital technologies that we have now really bringing the best out in us? How can we build future technologies that put people above profit? And how can designers, as well as citizens, companies, and authorities take action? To dig into this further, we called on Pernille Tranberg. That was her voice you heard earlier. Pernille is co-founder of European think tank dataethics.eu and definitely knows a thing or two about understanding data and democratizing data. Designer and futurist Lasse Underbjerg met up with Pernille to find out how far things have gone with data privacy and data ethics and what we as designers can do about it.
You're listening to
Yellow.
Today I'm joined by Pernille Tranberg here in our Copenhagen office. Hello Pernille and welcome.
Hello Lasse, thank you very much.
To anyone that doesn't know you already, how do you explain what you do?
Well, I'm actually a former newspaper journalist. I gave that up 10, 12 years ago. And today I am still working as a journalist, but it's more explaining tech and the advantages and disadvantages of new technology. So I work partly with privacy, teaching children what is the role of data and their data, personal data today, and how can they more or less take control of that? Because privacy is the right to decide who knows what about you when. And the other part, I work with data ethics, work with companies and governments, treating other people's personal data in an ethically responsible way. How do you do that and still make money on data? Can you do that? So I kind of advise about what is data ethics. How do you put human beings at the center when you deal with that data?
To give you your own question, what is data ethics?
Data ethics is treating other people's personal data in an ethically responsible way, respecting our human rights, respecting our privacy. There are many different types of data. There are non-personal data and personal data. And we're mostly probably going to talk about personal data, which is identifying you, you're a man, you're this age, you have this sexual orientation. That's personal data. Whereas non-personal data is data about the weather or data about a product or data about traffic. And then in between, you can have what you can say is anonymized data, where you use personal data, but you make sure that it can't be identified. So you just can use it for patterns. How are we driving on this road? How are we dealing with different health issues and stuff? But it's not about how you are doing it, but how we are doing it.
Deep personalization is often seen as a holy grail in a lot of businesses.
You can personalize. the best way to personalize is with using the data you got directly from the customer. Using data you got indirectly through third-party cookies, for example, is often felt as creepy from your customer. Where do you know that I bought this suit? So let's say I'm a customer with a bookstore. Of course I would like to hear that I bought this book 5 years ago. Now there's another book from this author. But I understand that because I told them 5 years ago, right? That's fine. That's personalization with the data I gave them. But if they suddenly give me a book about Alzheimer's because I was searching their website, then I feel it's creepy. That's where I totally lose control. Where do they know that from? A lot of people don't understand how data is shared in that way. So I would really think about that as a company. There are lots and lots of other things where you can use design to lure data out of people. And just think about it. So if you buy something and they pre-check a lot of things, well, you get the new offers from us in the future. You also get a newsletter and it's pre-checked. That's design, which is deceiving. I also think it's illegal, but we haven't seen a case yet. It shouldn't be pre-checked. Pre-checked. You have to check it yourself. But a lot of them are pre-checking it. And it is, on paper, illegal. We just haven't seen the fines yet.
It sounds scary. I mean, are we living in a post-privacy world? And
no.
Do we still have time to save it?
That's what I have to believe in. Because if we can't save our privacy, we won't save human beings and we won't save democracy. So I do believe that we can do it. But it might be, unfortunately, mainly the privileged, at least in the beginning, who will have this. The rich and the famous and the powerful, they would really need this. And they would be able to pay their way out of this. So just like with organic food, privacy will be for the rich to begin with. You can see Apple today is really working good with privacy. It's a really, really good company, actually. And in many of the rich countries, we can afford having an Apple product. So we have much better privacy when you're an Apple user than a Chrome or Android user. There are lots and lots of good ways of using data. And if we start looking at all the data, which is not personal data, then we have a lot of possibilities in our society, like Vestas using wind data. They get wind data from, I think, 35,000 different stations sending in wind data constantly to a big computer. So they know exactly where to place a wind turbine to produce optimal energy. Before they had all this data, it could take up to 1.5 years to find out the right placement. Now it's a click on the computer. That's a really good way of using data. They can even sell that wind data. It might be a big company wanting to understand wind data around the world because they sell ships around the world, so they have to annoy the bad wind, right? So that's a good way of using data. You can also use product data to measure when will a piece of your car break down so you can actually repair it before it breaks down and you avoid costs of delays and stuff like that. So there are many, many good ways of using data. If we're talking about personal data, you can even use personal data as well if you anonymize it properly. So let's say you are the Dutch company TomTom. You have a lot of location data in GPSs. You can sell that data to the police, for example. They did that. They sold some of the anonymized data to the police so they knew exactly where to check out where people drove too fast. If it's properly anonymized, it's not a problem. You can do that with a lot of different data, with location data and music data and health data. You can look after patterns and use that to make a better product or make a better society. So we're not limited here. Where we are limited is how we anonymize data. And we have to work more on that and also find a certification auditing scheme here. So when a company says, well, I've anonymized data, they have to prove it. It's probably anonymized. Nothing is 100% safe, but it could be 96% safe or something, right? So anonymization is a really good thing.
Where do you draw the line in terms of anonymizing data? Because one could argue that, you know, the more personal, the more granular the data is, the better you can use it.
I mean, I'm not that much into understanding the different levels of anonymization, honestly. I can't do that. But I know that, of course, there are different levels. Where I think what we could do is a German proposal is to actually forbid de-anonymization, which is really interesting. So if you, as a company or government, you have some data, you send it out, it can be de-anonymized. All data can be de-anonymized. But if anybody is doing it, you could find them. But I can't really say anything about how granular it should be, because I know the more safe it is in anonymization, the harder it is to use.
Why is de-anonymization of data not illegal throughout the world or even throughout EU?
I don't think we have enough examples of abuse of anonymized data, which has been de-anonymized and then abused. But when we get that, it will be illegal. It is a new proposal from the German government, and they are very first mover on regulation. So we'll probably see it.
Are there any other learnings we can take from Germany being your good example?
Well, a lot of people mock Germany because they're very far behind in digitalization. I know they have much more cash than they have in Sweden, for example, or in Denmark even. They don't even have a common address registry. So they're very much behind. But as I don't really think that being behind in digitalization is that big of a disaster. Of course, it's pretty nice in Denmark that we have a very efficient system where we can put up our data when it comes to taxes and stuff like that. And we are much further here than Germany, but they are taking time to think sometimes. Whereas we don't think that much. We say, well, we should experiment with this. And, well, in Silicon Valley, they say this is really, really cool and it will help us a lot. And then we start it without really thinking of reflecting if this is a good idea. Is it really a good idea to put kids into small boxes and put a prediction on them whether they are going to be abused or whether they are going to be neglected by their parents? Is that a really good idea? Can't we do this in another more human way than putting all the kids in this municipality into one box and then use data to predict about their future? You know, it's a big ethical question. We don't have ethical thinking in the way we use data enough. They have that in Germany. They have bad experience with abuse of knowledge and data, so they are much more reflective. That's why they are slower.
The argument is that, of course, computers and algorithms can be much more efficient, you could say, at predicting based on big amounts of data. What's the argument for not doing that and having a human doing it instead?
It depends on what you want to predict. So if you want to predict whether your product is going to be out of order in 2 weeks, or it depends on what you predict. If you predict on humans, when we should think, do we want that prediction? Maybe we want predictions on very rare diseases, which we already have. But do you want predictions on whether you have 79% likability of becoming unemployed in 10 years? Or that you have 29% likability that you will get cancer? Maybe we should do it another way. Maybe we should analyze your current behavior and say, well, you probably will have to go to live healthy if you want to live longer, you know. I mean, we're just doing a lot of predictions where we put ourselves into boxes, and ethics is about humans at the center. Is this good for humans or not?
Do you think ignorance is bliss?
No. I think ignorance is really sad in a way, because ignorance also made us give all our data to companies who told us that you can do that, for example. So, of course, ignorance is not good. Looking at highly educated, rich societies in the world, they are not typically ignorant, right?
So you deciding what to share and when and with whom.
Yeah.
It's easy to say, but it seems very hard to put in practice.
It's very hard to put in practice. But I mean, in 10 years, you'll see it will be very different. There are lots and lots of startups today working on this, where you can have your data and you can enrich your own data. One example could be you ask your telephone company that to get all your location data. And you can put that into a new service. It's not there yet, but you put it into this new service and it calculates a new biking route for you. So when you bike to work, it's much more scenic and there's no pollution. That could be a service where you could use your location data. Today we have a service where you can tell your bank, give this service called Spear in Denmark, give this service my economic data. And the bank has to do it because a new law told them to. And they will help you get a better view on your own economic data. So in that way, you'll see much more innovation in the future where you can activate your own data. So it's not only Facebook or Google and all the other really smart companies who take advantage of your data. You can do it yourself. I don't believe ever that you'll get, you should sell your data, because some companies are trying to make you believe that you can get money out of your data. And maybe you can get a little money, but that will be poor people selling their data. You should just use your data to get a better life. And the first people who will do this are probably patients. People with an illness will want their data. Maybe also, you know, sports athletes, they use data to optimize their bodies. So there are groups where we could see this start.
So how do I know who to trust, whether it be like big organizations that have been there for a long time or a new startup that is saying that they're privacy focused? What are some of the signs I can look for in who to trust?
The problem is that you have to look for signs yourself today. And I just want to say that in 10 years, we'll have help for this. We just like with the environment, you can't decide yourself what is organic and what is not organic. Today, you can just buy organic because it's labeled organic. There are certification schemes and auditing, so it helps consumers. We'll see this within privacy and ethics as well. So you, in the future, okay, there's a, this one, you can trust this one, right? But today you have to think yourself. And some of my tips would be, one, what do they live from? Do they live purely from your data, or do they just give away this service because they make money on something much bigger? Or do they charge for your product? That's one thing. Where do they have a headquarter? That's sometimes really hard to see where a company has a headquarter. But of course, in Europe, we have better laws. So if it has a headquarter in Europe, I would go for that. Then, of course, I would read their terms of conditions and privacy policies, which is hell reading. But you can also check, search the company on a search engine and see if anybody is bitching about it if it's cheating with your data, it's out there somewhere. Somebody will tell you.
Have you actually read the terms and conditions of every service you use?
No, of course I haven't. But when I went on Facebook 10, 11, 12 years ago, I was working at the consumer agency in Denmark, and there was a lawyer who had read the terms and conditions, and she told me what they were. And I said, oh my God, I shouldn't give them my data, you know. So that's why on Facebook, I'm 10 years younger, I'm a lesbian, and I live in Shanghai. And I have a fake name, of course, because I don't trust what they're saying. So, and that's another very unethical thing. If you have terms of conditions or privacy policies which ordinary people don't understand, then you're not ethical. You have to explain to a 12-year-old what you're doing with their data. And it's possible. I have examples of companies doing this. For example, a German app called Clue, where young women use that to measure their fertility. And here, a 12-year-old can understand what they do with data and what they don't do with data. There's a reason why it's very hard to understand.
And what's that reason?
That they don't want you to understand.
Why?
Because they're using your data to make a profit, or in a way you don't want to them to use your data. If everybody understood when they signed onto Facebook that they don't own their own data and Facebook can do whatever they want with the data, really, and did, then a lot more people would say, no, I don't want that. Or they would lie on Facebook, right?
How can we make them understand?
Well, we can work on privacy policies, which is understandable. And we can work with trust marks, certification schemes. So this Clue app, which I told you, should definitely have a trust mark. So young girls, when they went on this, they could say, oh, this one has this European, okay, organic certification compared to this one from the US who can sell the data whenever they want. Because when we talk about health data in the US, it's only regulated hard if it's in the hands of doctors and insurance companies.
What's some of the most important variables when talking about, you know, designing a trust mark for data ethics and privacy?
It is, of course, having a kind of a standard, which we really don't have today. But in Europe, we have made various standards. We have now guidelines within AI and ethics. We have GDPR. So we have different ways where we could put together and say, well, this is minimum. And it's not enough just to be compliant with GDPR. We have to do more. So it is possible doing this. And I know that I'm working on it. We'll see different certification schemes in the future.
What's some of the biggest roadblocks ahead in terms of giving people agency over their own data?
Profit, of course. That's so much money in data. And it's a bit old-fashioned only to look at profit as a company today, at least short-term profit, right? So I think it will change. But also profit in the sense of being a government, you can really save a lot of money. I mean, you could better control your population. So it's very hard both for some governments and companies to give you agency over your own data.
When do you think we will see this? When will, you know, other values than profit be more important for businesses?
Don't we really see that a little today with some of the most modern companies looking at the sustainable development goals? And I do think that a company like Lego, they have actually chosen treating children ethically, data-wise, than profit. Because you can make a lot of money right now stalking everybody with third-party cookies. So if you stop that, you probably stop short-term profit just on that. Marketing people will say, well, that's very important. It might change now, and we're seeing a change.
When you talk to big companies, how do you get them to understand their need for data ethics?
Well, I very, very often compare it to the environment, the environmental issues. It took a long time to get where we are today, and we are still not there. But most conscious, responsible companies today would have do green accounting or would have a green profile. That's something you would want in the future when it comes to data as well. And that's one way. Another way is to actually talk about them personally. You know, if you go to a CEO and they actually, most of them will have these thoughts themselves because they are powerful people and they would want private stuff. They need that. So also explaining why privacy is important for individuals and why you should treat your customers in the same way as you want to be treated yourself.
You use the environmental analogy. In that sphere, we've seen some greenwashing, some people call it. Do you think we'll see the same thing?
Well, we're already seeing privacy washing. We're seeing a lot of privacy washing. I mean, Facebook is the best one in privacy washing. Really, really, really perfect. You know, just having something called privacy settings, that's privacy washing because it's not true. There's no privacy on Facebook. If they should have called it social settings, or they might do a workshop in a conference which they call ethics by design, and that's not true. It depends on how you define privacy. So we're seeing privacy washing already.
Talking about companies, both big and small, and even public sector, what are some of the benchmarks for being ethical?
Yeah, it's not black and white today, right? Because we don't have a common set of standards for this. But one very good example is if you're a municipality website and if you use third-party cookies. So you share all the things I'm doing on your website with the whole ad tech industry. That's not ethical. Of course it's not. Because you're doing stuff on that website which is sensitive to you. So that's one part of it. Another part is that you might use small services on a website, which is where you don't have a data processing agreement with them. For example, there could be an internal search engine on the website. That could be Google, for example. Is that ethical? Giving Google all the data you're doing on the website? When you can actually choose a service, for example, a service called Cluedo, where you can get a data processing agreement. So another benchmark is, of course, all to be open about what you're doing. If you have any kind of ratings or scoring of customers or users, you should explain what you're doing with data. If a municipality is using data to look at how you are rated in schools, for example, then of course you should explain what data have you used. So explainability is really, really important. Not only transparency, but explainability. You must be able to explain what you've done to humans so they understand. Otherwise, maybe you shouldn't do it.
What can you do to take the discussion about data ethics and privacy into the boardroom meeting?
Well, it's already there. And I think it's in the boardrooms now. Especially in companies who are very responsible, I think it's already there because they are afraid of ending up at the front page of a tabloid newspaper. That's what drives a lot. They are afraid of a data leak. They are afraid of their reputation. They know they are vulnerable. They understand Cambridge Analytica. So I think it's there. The question is, how do we do this and how much do we do? And is it really a competitive advantage for us? And it's probably not a short-term competitive advantage, but a long-term, just like with the environment. 20 years ago, when you wanted to become a green company, it's not something you made money on the next day, right? But most do it today because they think in the long run, it's also about profits.
This is a very, very complex topic. And a lot of it is not black and white. What are some of the hardest dilemmas you face in your work with data ethics?
The hardest dilemmas, of course, is balancing between profit and being human-centered. Because it's totally okay companies have to make money. But should they make money so they abuse human beings' data? That's not fair. But where is the limit? Where is it okay? That's why I say that you can personalize if you get the data directly from the individual. And if you get the data directly from the individual and give them control, you can do so much more with data. So it's about partnering with your customers in a way instead of deceiving them and getting their data in all these deceiving ways, which is happening today. So that's a big dilemma. The dilemma is that Silicon Valley is really, really good. Some parts of Silicon Valley are very, very good at doing marketing. They're very, very good at abusing words. So everything which is totally tracking you is called smart. Smart city, smart everything. But in a way, a Nokia phone is actually smart, but it's being called a dumb phone. So it's also about use of words and marketing, right?
You talked about human centricity, I think you said. It's, of course, something, being a design company, we work a lot with. Is there a way to sort of design human-centric data use? Is it all about agency or are there other aspects to it?
It's also about, like, if you initiate a data processing, you have to ask yourself, who is this the benefit for? Who benefits from this? Is it mainly my profit? Is it society as a whole, or is it my customer? And of course, if it's only your profit, or if it's a system as a public sector, then it's not human-centric. you as a person, you are customer and society also is fine, but not only society. It should be you at the center as an individual. If you don't benefit from this service, then it's not ethical. So always ask yourself about that. It's also about, like, if you have a chatbot on your website. You have a chatbot and your customers are interacting with this chatbot. Does the chatbot tell the user that it's a chatbot and not a human? You should always tell a human that you're actually interacting with a chatbot, a computer. A lot of people won't know when you go online and you sit there and you post questions. You think it's a person sitting behind and it's not. And that's, I think they should always declare it's a bot. And there should always be a possibility of getting access to the human, to a human in the end. It's okay to use artificial intelligence on some very standard things, but in the end, there must be a level where you can get access to a human. And you must always declare that you are a computer. I really don't like all these companies who are designing androids or, you know, human-like robots. And they all look like beautiful women with long eyelashes and big fat lips. And they only do this to create feelings from the human being interacting with it. In a way, I would love if there was a law saying, if you are creating a robot looking like a human being, it should have a square head. It's very important that we as humans can tell the difference in the future also.
Talking about that, you know, effective computing, like computers starting to understand sort of our body language and our facial expressions, that's a whole nother level of data. I mean, can that even be done ethically?
Well, I just read about this little dog in Japan, which is a robot, and it has facial recognition in its eyes, so it can recognize you, its owner, and it can react to your facial expression if you're sad or not sad and stuff. And of course, if that should be done in an ethical way, you as a buyer should set it up yourself and decide what should it know. And the company behind should not take that data and use it for other purposes. So I do believe it could have been done ethically. The problem is that it's really, really hard to educate individuals about this. So as a society, we have to set a certain limit. It should be illegal not to declare that you're not a human being. But that also means that we have to define what is a human being in the future. Because if you as a human being has embedded yourself with lots of new technology in you, you might even be able one day to upload your own brain, which I don't believe, but some people believe in that. When will you stop being a human being? So we have to define that probably.
I think that's a very, very good question to end on. Thank you very, very much for coming over and having this chat with us.
You're welcome. It's been really giving for me as well.
Do you have faith in humanity?
That's what I'm fighting for. Yes, I have faith in humanity. The problem is with humanity is that there are lots of bad humans and there are lots of good humans, right? So it's really hard to say that you're fighting for humanity because there are also some really dumb bastards out there.
You're listening to YELLO.
Thanks to Pernille Tranberg for sharing her thoughts and experience. Once again, you can find out more about Pernille's work at dataethics.eu. Thanks also to Lasse for guiding the conversation. And you, lovely listeners, thanks for joining us. If you arrived at this episode and wonder what the bigger idea is for the podcast, take a listen to episode 0. Everything you need to know is in there. Look out for new episodes on your favourite podcast platforms. Subscribe even, then you'll never miss a thing. And keep in mind, if there's a topic, person or story you'd like us to cover, then get in touch at yellow@designit.com and we'll see what we can do. I've been your host, Phil, and this has been the first ever episode of Yellow by Designit. See you next time.
YELLO.